And your profit on top of the principal is guaranteed as well. Believe it or not, this is an interest-bearing loan. And again, believe it or not, you are the lender, and the bank actually is the borrower. You might say, well, how come that bank that has millions of dollars is borrowing money from me, and I'm the, you know, the poor guy who has only $5,000 lending money to the bank? Yes, it doesn't matter actually who has money and who does not have money. It doesn't matter who is the strong part and who is the weak part in this example. What matters is actually is the interpretation of the transaction itself. You give money to the bank, and the bank, of course, does have the right to utilize the money. And what kind of use actually you are talking about? The bank actually is re-lending money to others. The bank actually guarantees you 3% interest or profit or revenue, call it whatever you want, because that is interest. And actually he lends the same amount, 5,000, our example, to XYZ individual for 6 or 7% interest, and he makes a profit by keeping the difference. So he pays you 3% and he charges 6% and keeps 3% for himself. Why opening a saving account is not allowed? Because again, I mean, you are lending money to the bank where the principal is guaranteed, and the profit that you gain on top of the principal is guaranteed as well. That is the nature of interest-bearing loans. If the bank actually is not allowed, the bank is not allowed to touch the money, that could be wadi'ah, like a trust. I mean, you put some money with XYZ individual just to save that money. Okay, if it is wadi'ah, then the bank is not allowed to use it. Okay, if it is mudarabah, for example, or a kind of partnership, if it is a partnership, then you cannot guarantee your principal, leave aside to guarantee your profit. It's neither, none of the above. The bank actually does use the money. The bank makes money from your money. The bank guarantees your principal, guarantees your profit on top of it, and that's again the nature of interest-bearing loans. That's why opening a saving account is not allowed. Credit card, holding credit card. What does it mean to hold a credit card? What does it mean? It means that you have a line of credit. You have a ceiling. You have a maximum amount where you can take or you can borrow from others, from a credit card, an answer, or just giving a fatwa. We need to reinterpret that transaction from a fiqh perspective. What does it mean that you do not have a checking account? You are not withdrawing money from your checking account. You are taking money from somebody else. You're taking money from somebody else. When you take money from somebody else, it means that you are borrowing money. So there is a loan involved here. Well, if you want to go with the book, according to the Islamic principles, that loan actually has to be an interest-free loan. That loan has to be an interest-free loan. It's not the case 100% when it comes to using credit card. Okay, certain scenarios, you borrow money and you pay the money back with no consequences, without paying anything. And in certain scenarios, actually, you borrow money and you pay way more than what you have taken. So using credit card actually is something in between. It needs more elaboration. The fact that you are borrowing money from others is fine. However, the ideal situation, is that you are not supposed to agree. You are not supposed to agree on paying interest, period, no matter what the situation might be. And you cannot proceed with your application, you cannot get a credit card without signing an agreement, either online or in front of the agent. You just, you know, sign a document that, yes, I am willing to abide with all the rules and with all the regulations and all the clauses of the agreement between you and the bank, including your agreement on paying interest in certain cases. So if you do those certain, you know, cases, you have to pay interest. But if you do not, then you do not have to pay. Then you do not have to pay. This actually takes us to another very relevant issue, which is the difference between whatever is haram for itself in our Sharia and our deen versus whatever is haram for other causes. There is something called haram li dhatihi and something else called haram li ghayrihi. I mean, we need to understand this kind of you know, classification or differentiation between different levels of haram in our Sharia. One more time, al-haramu lidhatihi, which means prohibited for itself, is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prohibited because the actual act is a haram one. The actual act is a haram one. Okay? And anything else that might lead to it, might lead or might mislead to it actually, is still haram, but it's not as prohibited as the haram itself. Very good example for that is drinking or consuming alcohol. Okay? Drinking wine or beer or consuming alcohol. That's haram li dhati. That is haram li dhati. I mean, the ultimate haram that could be done when it comes to wine and beer is to drink. So that's something haram li dhati. However, manufacturing, transporting, buying, selling, commissioning is still haram. But it's not as haram as consuming or drinking alcohol. Again, all of them are haram, but the most severe act that you could ever done is to drink yourself and to get intoxicated. Anything else actually is still haram. But again, it's not as haram as drinking alcohol. When it comes to riba, which is our topic for tonight, borrowing money with interest, if you know from day one that the 1,000 that you are borrowing from the credit card company, from Chase, from Capital One, from Bank of America, will be paid back 1,000 plus, that is haram li dhati, because you know that you are getting involved in riba from day one. However, if you borrow money, without being obligated to pay interest by default, rather, if you use your credit card, you know, for certain transactions, then you have to pay interest. But if you avoid those transactions, then you do not have to pay interest. That is still haram because, again, you are agreeing on paying interest, and that is haram. However, this kind or this level of prohibition is not as severe. It's not as severe as when you borrow money with interest from day one, and that's why using credit card actually is haramun li ghayrihi, prohibited for its potential consequences. Once you hold a credit card, if you use it for ATM cash withdrawal, then you have to pay interest. Okay? If you delay your payment, like after the due date, then you have to pay interest. If you get involved in an installment, if you decide not to pay, you know, in full before the due date, then you have to pay interest. But the question here, what if not? What if you did not use your credit card for cash withdrawal? What if you did not, you know, delay your payment after the due date? What if you are so punctual and so, you know, caring, so much so that even before the due date, you pay the, you know, the total credit statement in full, and you do the same every single month? Where is the riba coming from? I mean, there is no riba. I know a lot of brothers and sisters, mashallah, they use their credit card, and for the last years and years, they did not even pay one single penny as interest. And that's why our scholar said, al-haramu li dhatihi, whatever is prohibited for itself. I want you to remember drinking wine or beer. That's haramun li dhatihi. Al-haramu li dhatihi, la tubihuhu illa al-darura. Whatever is classified or identified as prohibited for itself could not be permitted unless there is a necessity. Wal-haramu li ghayrihi tubihuhu al-haja. And whatever is prohibited for other causes would be permitted in case of public and general need. Our needs actually are not in the same level. Our needs as humans are not in the same level. There is something called darura, necessity. In some cases, it's even a life or death situation, something that you cannot even survive without. And some other needs are still, you know, legitimate and still, you know, we cannot function well without. However, they are not as important, as essential as the darurat, and that's called al-hajat. So the fiqh maxim here is that al-haramu li dhati tubihuhu al-darura. Whatever is prohibited for itself could not be permitted unless there is a necessity. Someone actually under threatening, under compulsion or enforcement, okay, was requested to, you know, drink wine. Otherwise, he or she will be killed. Do you think that drinking wine in this particular scenario would be allowed or not? And he knows for sure that if he did not drink at that time, he would be killed. Okay, Can he drink or not? Yes, he can, because that's the rule. He wants to save his own life. الحرام لذاته تبيحه الضرورة والحرام لغيره تبيحه الحاجة. Whatever is prohibited for other causes would be permitted in whenever there is a legitimate need. Need actually is a it has to be defined well. Okay. Do you think that there is a need for us Muslims living in this society to use credit card? I do claim yes, there is a general and public need. Maybe my particular need for using credit card is different than yours, different than his, different than her need. But at the end of the day, people actually need to use a credit card. To establish a credit history, you have to have a credit card. To do some certain transactions, you cannot proceed without having a credit card. You go to some points of sale in which cash is not accepted. Debit card is not accepted. Personal checks are not, it has to be credit card. So again, generally speaking, there is a legitimate and public need for using credit card. Okay, if you want to apply the qaida that we discussed, al-haramu li-ghayrihi tubihu al-haja, whatever is prohibited for other causes would be permitted in case of need. It means that using credit card actually is permissible as needed. Having said that, once you hold a credit card, do not exaggerate in use it only as needed. Okay, and if you stop after a while, by the way, if you stop, you will start losing scores. So you need to keep utilizing your credit card to keep up your good credit scores. If you have like 750 plus, then you are in a very good shape. In order for you to keep the 750 up to 800, you need to keep using your credit card. Avoid cash withdrawal. Do not use your credit card for cash withdrawal. Because if you do so, you will be charged twice. Charge number one, service fees, which is very legitimate, very, very justifiable. And charge number two, interest. Okay, you borrow money with interest, you have to pay interest, and that is haram. Certain credit cards consider any international transaction as if it is a cash withdrawal, believe it or not. Certain credit companies consider any international transaction that you do while being in the US, it is counted as if it is a cash withdrawal. So if you purchase something from Nigeria, from Saudi Arabia, for example, while living in the US, okay, you will be charged, number one, wire transfer, because the money will be transferred from the US to Nigeria, and that is very justified, very, you know, permissible. You will be charged currency exchange. The credit card company, believe it or not, they make some money out of, you know, the currency exchange, some profit, which is fine. And number three, they charge you interest on the actual amount has been utilized for that international transaction. You need to double check with your credit card company and find out. If that is the case, then you have to stop. You have to stop immediately using your credit card for international transaction. Can you use your debit card, by the way, for cash withdrawal? Of course you can, because there is no lending activities involved. Debit card means that you have a checking account. Instead of just walking to the bank and withdrawing cash, you use your debit card remotely to withdraw from your checking account. So if you stop by any ATM machine and take some cash money, it does not mean at all that you are borrowing money. You are using your own money. And definitely you will be charged maybe flat rate or like lump sum for, you know, per transaction, which is absolutely fine. Let's talk briefly about about mortgage. When you say mortgaging a house, again, we are here trying to, like, you know, unlock the secrets of contemporary transactions. What does it mean mortgaging a house? Mortgaging a house actually is a combination of three different transactions at the same time. I mean, they go simultaneously. They go together simultaneously. Transaction number one is a sale agreement or a sale contract. You, as a client, as a customer, buy a house from the landlord. And that is a straight halal transaction. وَأَحَلَّ اللَّهُ الْبَيْعَ وَحَرَّمَ الرِّبَ. So you're talking about sale contract, which is halal. Number two, there is a loan agreement where the mortgage company, I'm talking about conventional mortgage, where the mortgage company pays the price of your house on your behalf to the landlord. So they pay on your behalf $100,000, and you have to pay it maybe $150,000 on 10, 15, 25, 30 years, whatever the payment plan might be. And we have a big concern here. Okay? We have a big concern here because the mortgage company is, quote unquote, lending you money. The mortgage company is lending you money. Okay? If it is an interest-free loan, $100,000 to be paid back $100,000, then you're good to go. But actually, it does not happen in the real life. So you take $100,000, instead of taking it cash money, and you have the freedom of using the money in the way that you want, they pay it on your behalf. They write a check to the landlord and just pay him the price of the house on your behalf, which means 100% that they are lending you the money. So you are a borrower, and the mortgage company actually is the lender. We have a big concern when it comes to this particular, you know, lending activity because it is an interest-bearing loan. Transaction number three is the mortgage one. Mortgage, according to the Quranic, you know, definition, is a halal. Mortgage actually is to use the house as a collateral. I mean, you provide the house, you agree to offer your house as a collateral, okay, to secure the fund that you have borrowed from others. Well, taking or mortgaging the property of the borrower is permissible. As a matter of fact, it is sunnah, if this is the only way for you as a lender to secure your money. وَإِن كُنْتُمْ عَلَىٰ سَفَرٍ وَلَمْ تَجِدُوا كَاتِبًا فَرِهَانٌ مَقْبُوضًا. You see? So الرِّهَان or الرَّهَن actually is a pure Islamic Quranic, you know, transaction. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about interest-free loan, not interest-bearing loan. Okay, so as a principle, is it okay for the mortgage company to mortgage your property to secure their fund? Of course it is permissible because they want to secure their money. I mean, they have given you $100,000 and you will be taking your sweet time. We're talking about 10, 15, 20, 30 years until you pay the amount back plus interest. So as a concept, in order for them to secure their money, they ask for collateral. There is nothing wrong with that. Again, the main concern that we have here is the second transaction, which is the interest-bearing loan, where you borrow money with interest from the mortgage company. Is it reasonable to ask the mortgage company to lend you money with no interest? Of course, no. Because the mortgage company is not a charitable organization. It's not a Life for Relief or Zakat Foundation or ICNA Relief. I mean, it's a business. I mean, they want to make money, which is fine. We do not have any issue with that. However, it has to be done accordingly. It has to be, I mean, in order for them to make money, they have to do it accordingly, according to the Islamic principles, not according to the conventional, you know, finance system. What is the Islamic principle here? Islamic principle is that in order for you to make money as a mortgage company, you need to take some risk. And this risk actually comes from the position or the ownership of the property, which makes it clear that the mortgage company cannot proceed with the transaction before taking ownership. The mortgage company has to own the property, has to possess, has to collect the property, making sure that the property is the property of the mortgage company. So that risk actually is involved, so much so that if something happened to the property, to the house, before selling it back to you, or before renting it back to you, if something happened, who will be incurring the loss? It has to be the mortgage company itself. It has to be the mortgage company itself. And that's why whenever we have Islamic finance, genuine and sound Islamic finance, you will see it clear. You will see it clear that the Islamic mortgage company or the Islamic bank or the Islamic investment company, even if it is non-Islamic one, but they go with the Islamic principles, they have to buy the property, closing the property, becoming the exclusive owner of the property. And then after that, they can do whatever they want. They can go with lease to own option. They can go with the murabaha option. they buy it spot sale, the property spot sale for $100,000, and sell it back to you for maybe $150,000, you know, with an installment of 10, 15, 20, 20 years. If you zoom out and compare mortgage company with Islamic mortgage company, the outcome might be the same. The mortgage company paid $100,000 on your behalf, and you have to pay it $150,000, and the Islamic mortgage company, okay, gave you $100,000, and you have to pay it back $150,000. So if someone does not have that solid, strong fiqh background, he might say, well, what is the difference? If I go with Countrywide or I go with Guidance Residential, it's going to be the same. It's $100,000 for $150,000. This actually misunderstanding has been raised a while ago. The matter of fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala captured this misconception in the Quran itself. ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّهُمْ قَالُوا إِنَّمَا الْبَيْعُ مِثْلُ الرِّبَى وَأَحَلَّ اللَّهُ الْبَيْعَ وَحَرَّمَ الرِّبَى. If you go like pure mortgage option, there is no ownership, there is no risk, there is no risk. The mortgage company actually goes through a very riskless transaction. They offer you $100,000 and you have to pay it back $150,000, guaranteed by law. You have to pay back the principal, you have to pay back the interest, you have to pay back the interest. The Islamic mortgage company does not offer you a loan. Rather, they buy the house either jointly with you, like you buy 5% and they buy 95%, like what Guidance Residential does, or they might go with Murabaha. They buy it spot sale for 100,000 and they sell it back to you for 150,000. Or they might go with the lease to own. They buy it again, close on it, become the owner, okay, and they sign a long-term lease agreement with you. Okay, either lease to own or just lease contract, and toward the end of the lease contract, they agree to transfer the title to you for maybe $1 or $10, just nominal price, I mean, to let it go. So before making money, they have to take a certain level of risk. They do not have to lose money, but they have to take the responsibility of ownership. This is actually what the Prophet ﷺ clearly indicated in several ahadith. نهى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عن بيع ما لم يقبض. Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم prohibited from selling before possessing, before owning, before collecting. وعن ربح ما لم يضمن. As well as he prohibited taking a profit without taking responsibility. وعن ربح ما لم يضمن. As well as he prohibited, you know, taking profit without taking risk. So this is actually what we believe in the Islamic finance system, that the traditional lending system is a very unfair. Why the bank or the mortgage company, you know, takes full advantage of the less fortunate individuals, which is me and you, by just imposing on them whatever, you know, certain percentage of interest might be, and the principal is guaranteed and the profit is guaranteed, and there is zero risk involved here. Someone might say, well, there is always a possibility of default, which means that some people nowadays try to justify what mortgage companies do by saying, well, the borrower actually might default. Well, that's absolutely correct. But the default actually is not the risk that we are talking about. The default is not the risk that we are talking about, because the default actually happens in the mortgage process and it happens in the Islamic mortgage process. Always there is a possibility of default. This is not what you are talking about. The risk that you are talking about, or the liability you're talking about, is the liability of the possible damage or loss or depreciation in the property itself. We have to prove from the beginning that, oh, there is a certain level of risk, okay, has been taken by the mortgage company. You call it Islamic, you call it traditional mortgage, it does not make any difference. As long as the transaction is done Islamically, you know, correct, we do not mind. Even if you deal with Chase or with Bank of America, if they do it Islamically right, go for it. If they do it like a pure, straightforward murabaha, go with Chase, go with Countrywide, go with whatever mortgage company you want. But we have to prove that there is an actual real ownership assumed by the mortgage company, by the lender, by the investor, by the financier, call him whatever you want, before we proceed with the transaction. And that's why the default rule here, default rule, is that mortgaging a house is not allowed. Mortgaging a house because of the interest-bearing loan involved in it. Several options that Islamic mortgage companies have, as I said, they can go with a diminishing partnership, they can go with murabaha, they can go with ijara. We have actually several so-called Islamic mortgage companies in the U.S. The most famous ones actually are five or six. Okay, one of them is called Amin Housing, that is headquartered in California. They do not deal with the secondary market. They do not sell their contracts. They do not sell their contracts to Freddie Mac or Fidi May. I am actually the Sharia advisor of this particular company. I did review their contract. I came up with some observations along with my colleague Sheikh Jamal Zarabozo Hafizahullah. We get back to Amin Housing and we ask them to do some corrections, and actually they did. So I do believe if they practice on the ground whatever whatever is written in the agreement, this is actually one of the ideal options that you have. Problem here is that because Amin Housing does not deal in the secondary market or with the second, which means that they cannot liquidate their money within just a few weeks after doing the transaction, their financial capacity is very limited, very, very limited. They cannot serve more than maybe 30, 35, 40, Muslim families a year, which is nothing, literally nothing, comparison to the desperate need of Muslims in the U.S. However, the option actually is there, and you have to be like one of the investors with Amin. I mean, you have to pitch in some money in order for you to line up and just wait for your time to buy your own house. After that, we have five more companies. We have Guidance Residential, and we have Devon Bank, and we have University Islamic Financial, and we have Ijara Loan, and we have La Riba. Okay. In our Fiqh Council, the Assembly of Muslim Jurists of America, just for my curiosity, have you heard about Amja? Can I see some hands? Amja? Have you heard about Amja Fiqh Council? The Assembly of Majma Fiqh al-Sharia of America? No? Sisters? Okay. We do actually hold imams training on an annual basis, and we choose particular, specific topic. We discuss it actually in depth, and we come up with recommendations. This is actually our human effort. We might be right, we might be wrong, Allahu alam. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that we do not issue any fatwa or declaration without doing our due diligence, without spending a lot of time and effort and money in order for us to investigate and to find out, that whatever we post actually is the most correct opinion to the utmost of our ability. We did our own research on those five several companies, and actually we invited them back in 2014 to come and to do a presentation in front of us, in front of the fatwa committee, to see what kind of model they have. And we do have like copies from their contracts. We did not ask for those copies. Actually, Muslims in the U.S., ask us as members in the fatwa committee, and they share the contract of Guidance Residential and La Riba, and they ask us, do you think that this is halal or haram? And they make it clear, do not give me details. I'm a very common individual. Do not tell me some technical, tell me that this contract is halal, so you go for it, and this contract actually is haram, avoid it. So we try to keep it as simple as possible. If you Google Amja Islamic Mortgage Companies, you will see a declaration written in both in Arabic and in English. After listening to the presentation of the Sharia board members of those companies or whosoever actually has Sharia advisory board, and after doing our own analysis and our own investigation, our own research, we came up with the following, that the best option again is Amin Housing. Amin Housing is not available for everybody. Right after that, Guidance Residential. Guidance Residential actually goes with a very simple model called diminishing partnership. Al-Musharaka, Al-Mutanaqisa, Al-Muntahiya, Bit-Tamliq, diminishing partnership. Which means that they buy the property jointly with you, and they ask for as minimal as 5% where you can join. Of course, you have to be qualified to join Guidance Residential for financing. They check your credit history and your employment history and your income. Once you are qualified, you need to come up with at least 5% to buy the house jointly with Guidance Residential. In the same agreement, you agree, both with them, that you will be renting their share. So you start with 5% and Guidance Residential 95%. And, you know, since you occupy the property and start using it, you start renting those 95% and buying their shares gradually, month by month. So you start 5%, 95%. Maybe next month you become 6% owner versus 94%, 7%, 93%, all the way until you kick them out of the deal by being the 100% owner, and they are the zero owner in this project or this agreement between you and them. We did actually, you know, analyze and study, you know, deeply this contract. Some of us in the fatwa committee were with the impression that in the past, maybe for the last 10 years before 2014, we were with the impression that, you know, this model actually is not Sharia compliant enough. After some, you know, verification with Mufti Taqi Uthmani through our, you know, the president of AMJA, Dr. Hussein Hamid Hassan, we found out that the model or the structure of this agreement actually is reasonable enough, like could be tolerated, called Sharikatul Milk instead of Sharikatul Aqd. It's a long story. Long story short, dealing with this company actually is reasonable enough. Yani if you want to buy a house for residential purposes, then have a peace of mind and just finance your house with this company. You are not committing anything haram. You are not getting involved in riba. There are certain scenarios where Guidance Residential actually does share the profit and loss with you, certain scenarios. And that's actually enough to permit the transaction, providing that they put their name on the title as an owner, along with yourself as a customer. And as I said, you start buying their share and renting the rest of their shares until you kick them out of the deal by becoming the 100% owner, and they are the 0% owner. There are some glitches in the contract here or there when it comes to property tax, when it comes to maintenance, when it comes to insurance. They have their own justification on why they do not want to share those expenses. Although, I mean, if you want to go with the ideal situation, if you want to go with the book, if we are partners, then we have to share the expenses. They said, well, you are the one who is occupying the property. So the property tax actually is utilized for the service of the resident himself. We are not living there. I mean, you enjoy the streets and the parks and the police, you know, department and the public school system. All these different services are funded, you know, by the property tax. If you are the one who is living there, then you take care of your own tax. Is that something, you know, reasonable? I mean, does have, you know, some logic behind it? Yes, actually, it does. Okay. Even if we agree that their approach is wrong 100%, okay, just go with the worst case scenario, that they have to share their percentage of the tax. Being waived or excusing themselves from paying the property tax does not render the whole agreement to be an interest-bearing one. Because the most important thing is what? Is the ownership. The most important thing is the ownership. And the ownership actually is there. Prophet ﷺ said, Al-Kharaju bil-Daman. Al-Kharaju bil-Daman, which means that profit follows liability. Do they make profit? Of course they make. Okay? Do they take some risk up to certain limit? Yes, I mean, they take some risk. Within the given circumstances, as Muslims living in the U.S., providing that other Islamic alternatives are not as genuine, as sound, as legitimate, as Guidance Residential, we reached to a conclusion as a fatwa committee that, you know, this company is reasonable enough. As a matter of fact, some of us, including myself, we financed our own homes with Guidance Residential. After that, I mean, I'm going in order. Number one, are you following up with me? Number one is Amin Housing, and number two is Guidance Residential. And then we have number three, we have two different companies who are in the same level. Again, to the utmost of our ability, we might be right, we might be wrong. We might change our mind in the same way that we change our mind when it comes to Guidance Residential. We keep saying that Guidance is not allowed for maybe 10 years. And then we discovered that we were mistaken. There is a way to justify it, and we changed our mind with the pleasure, actually. We do not have any issue, you know, or anything personal against those companies. However, we have been entrusted by our community to, you know, declare whatever we believe is correct. So to the utmost of our ability, guidance residential is a very reasonable option. If you want to buy a house, go with this option without even having hesitance or reluctance that you are doing something haram or something wrong. After that, you have two different companies. We have UIF, University Islamic Financial, and we have Devon Bank. Devon Bank actually is a community bank, is a Jewish-based bank in Chicago, Illinois. And UIF is in Ann Arbor, Michigan. They both actually have two different models. They have murabaha, which is cost plus profit, which means that they buy and they sell. A child is crying there. They have a murabaha, they buy and they sell. And they have another model called ijara one. Ijara means you know, lease to purchase. Okay. We do not have any issue with the murabaha itself as a concept. We do not have any issue with the ijara itself as a concept. The problem, the serious issue that we have is with the implementation of those models. Do they really, both of them, in the same level, according to our fatwa, Devon Bank and University Islamic Financial, do they really buy the property, own it, close on it, okay, take the risk of any potential loss or damage or depreciation before selling the property back to the customer? The answer is no, big time. You just play with the terms of the contract, and if there is any ownership, it's a very, very fake, very nominal, very insignificant partnership that is not enough for me to have a peace of mind saying, well, this option actually is halal, or it is as halal as guidance residential. So again, we said that if you need to buy a house, then guidance residential is the best option for you. If you are not qualified, or if guidance residential is not licensed in your state, then you can go with Devon Bank, or you go with University Islamic Financial. When it comes to murabaha, or when it comes to ijara, I would say they are in the same level. We have a big question mark on those, you know, two different models as far as their application, not as far as murabaha and ijara as a theory, as I said. We didn't say that do not deal with the Devon Bank or with UIF, or it is haram. No, it's not. We said that if you are desperately in need and guidance residential is not an option for you for some reason, you disqualify, they do not operate in your state, then you can go with either Devon Bank or with University Islamic Financial. And then after that, we have two more companies, Ijara Loan and La Riba. Ijara Loan and La Riba. Ijara Loan actually goes with the lease to purchase. But the problem here is that Ijara itself as a company is a broker and not a lender. They do not have money to start with. Guidance Residential does have some money. They have some, you know, seed money where they started their business and they now like liquidate and get back their money through the secondary market. University Islamic Financial is a bank. Devon Bank is a bank. So they are lenders. Technically, they are investors. They have money and they have a decision. I mean, they can make a decision. When it comes to Ijara Loan, they are not a bank to start with. They do not even have money to start with. And as they say here, no money, no honey, right? If you do not have money, you cannot make a decision. And this is actually exactly the case when it comes to Ijara Loan. They ask you the following. Go ahead and just shop around for any conventional loan. Go to any bank you want, any conventional bank you want, any mortgage company you want, and get your application approved. Can someone take care of the girl, please? Bismillah alik. فرجت وكنت أظنها لا تفرج الحمد لله. So they do not have money to start with. They tell you, go ahead and just, you know, shop around for any loan and get your conventional interest-bearing loan approved, and then you come to us. Okay? We have just a magic touch. Okay? We just convert that interest-bearing loan into a Sharia-compliant one. How do you do so? He said, well, we establish what's called a trust. Trust actually is an entity, is a legal entity. It's like LLC, Limited Liability Corporation. They establish something else called a trust. Okay? And they put themselves as a trustee, and they add you as a trustee. So that trust actually takes the money from the conventional mortgage company or conventional bank that you have been approved by. And the question here, how do they get the money? They borrow the money with interest from that bank. So instead of staying away from riba, you commit riba twice. How many times? Twice. Number one, when you approach Chase or Capital One and you apply for conventional loan, you get approved. This is violation number one. And violation number two, whenever the trust is established and you are a part of it, you are one of the trustees, and that trust actually walks to, you know, Chase that you have been approved by, and they take the money as a loan, as an interest-bearing loan. And that's why actually we said that dealing with the ijara loan is not an option, period. It's not an option, period. So you mortgage your house with Countrywide, with the Bank of America, or you mortgage your house with the ijara loan, to my knowledge, they are the same. Absolutely the same. I do not see any difference between the two. So this is not an option for you. And the last one, which is la riba. La riba actually, like, literally means no riba, or riba free. If you check the actual agreement, okay, or contract that you need to sign, it's a straightforward riba. So la riba actually is the actual riba. They call it la riba, just to give you the impression that, oh, mashallah, we are Sharia compliant and we follow the fatwa of Sheikh Al-Qaradawi or Sheikh XYZ. But when it comes to the actual agreement that you have to sign, it's a straightforward, you know, mortgage agreement. You borrow money, and you pay interest on it. Recently, I'm not going to mention names, they assigned one of the high caliber Islamic finance professionals, a friend of mine, a close friend of mine, actually. I know him very well. He knows me very well. We are close friends, and we communicate almost on a regular basis. He came up with some justification, came up with some justifications of the way that la riba does its business, and issued a fatwa that la riba actually is a Sharia compliant one. I disagree 100%. All the justifications that have been brought into the table do not make any sense for me. He came up with several ways of justifying what they do by signing aqd wakala, a contract of agency where the client buys the property under his name on behalf of la riba, and then on the closing date la riba comes and pay. I mean, all these justifications with all due respect, do not make any sense. Okay, I do believe until today, and the fatwa committee until today, as of today, we do believe that la riba is not an option. So you mortgage your house with Chase or with Capital One or Bank of America, or you go with la riba. Honestly, I do not see any difference between the two. As I said in the beginning, this is to the utmost of our ability. We might be wrong, Allahu A'lam. And as I said several times, that, you know, for the last 10 years, from 2000 until 2013 or 14, we used to say that guidance residential is not an option. And then we found out that we were wrong, and there is a way to justify, you know, guidance residential. So those are the five, you know, major companies that you hear about always: guidance residential, University Islamic Financial, Devon Bank, Ijara Loan, and La Riba. And I mentioned them in order. How much time we have, Sheikh Ahmed? How much time we have for Salat Isha? 10 more minutes for Isha. طيب, let me just stop here and take a few questions before we go for Salat Isha. The floor is yours. If we can have a moderator here like MC or someone to organize the discussion. Sheikh Ahmed, you want to take over?
He can start on in.
I cannot even turn it off.
For you to answer, you can keep it here. Far away.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. I have a few questions. You said for the credit cards, there is a general need for it. Is it the same thing for the purchasing house through the guidance or other companies? The other question is, you call the guidance.
Wait, let's go like one question per person. You said that. There is the need for every single one of us here to own his own house. We're gonna pass away one day, and we have to make sure that we secure something for ourselves during our lifetime and after our death. Financial stability actually is a part of our deen. Rasulullah said, "Al-yadul ulya khayrun min al-yadis sufla." The upper hand is better than the lower one. Okay? He said, "Innaka antadhara warathataka aghniya." خَيْرٌ مِّنْ أَنْ تَذَرَهُمْ عَالَةً يَتَكَفَّفُونَ النَّاسِ. Right? Leaving your inheritors, your family members, wealthy, well-established is way better than leaving them in need, begging people. So one of the fundamental needs for humans in general to fulfill is to have a house. So if there is a Sharia-compliant way to own your own house, okay, and just free yourself from paying rent, and whenever Allah forbids them, and after long life, inshallah, full of ta'ah and obedience. Whenever you pass away, you leave something for your kids. So is there a need for owning a house? Yes, there is a need. Is this need a pressing need and legitimate one? Yes, it is. Take me as an example. Before we issue a fatwa that guidance is halal, I spent the first 16 years of my life in the U.S. paying rent. Wallahi, I wasted tens of thousands of dollars. I mean, there was a fatwa that guidance residential is halal. So just to save and to invest that money in a house that I own myself instead of, wasting my money, to the landlord. The need actually is there. The need is there. Now, is it a darura, almost life or death situation? No. No, it's not. Is it a darura? No, it's not. If there is no Sharia-compliant option, I am willing to spend, the rest of my life living in this country without purchasing a house. Because the alternative is there, which is renting a house. I mean, what you are desperate for is to find a place to live in, but you do not have to be the owner. Well, if there is a way to own a house in a Sharia-compliant way, 70%, 80% Sharia-compliant one, okay, like guidance residential, for example, why not? You see? So the need is there, and the Islamic alternative actually is there, alhamdulillah. So go for it, take full advantage of that, and just buy your own house as soon as possible. When it comes to, keep it away from me, please, away. It's going to create a lot of echo here. Yeah. You have a question as well? Yeah, come in. Assalamu alaikum. You have a question?
No.
Maybe come back later on, okay? None of that. And when it comes to using credit card, again, your particular need might be different than mine. Might different than her or him. But at the end of the day, is there any public and general need for people to use a credit card in this society? If you live in Somalia, or you live in Saudi Arabia, or in Jordan, or in Algeria, you do not need to use a credit card. The system there actually is still, until today, people use cash money. So if you go back, to the Muslim world, or most of the Muslim, countries, you do not even need to use a credit card. And thus, using this particular credit card overseas is not allowed, because there is no desperate need for it. As long as you live in this society here, then actually the need is there. And based on that, yes, you can use credit card while being extra careful when it comes to transactions that might involve you in riba. Cash withdrawal, international transactions for some credit card companies, not to pay in full, or to delay your payment after the due date. As long as you are away from all those scenarios, then you can use your credit card for years and years and years without paying one single penny as an interest. Allah.
Let me use this one. You can use it. By the way, he told Imam can prolong the Isha.
What's that?
The Isha. We can pray lately or for the Isha.
So yeah, sure. So we're going to, inshallah, delay Salat al-Isha and take as many questions as possible, inshallah.
Check.
No.
So, Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi. First of all, we might have explained, but I might have missed. How do guidance recitation makes money? To my understanding, that this is no difference than any other lariba. They call it rent or call it fee or whatever you call it, name or interest. But there has to be a way to make money. That's number one. I want to clarify myself that how do guidance makes money and how it is correct. And second is, they also borrow money from Freddie Mac and Fannie Mae.
Let's go one question. How does guidance residential make money? That's a good question. They make money from the rent. They make money from the rent. The monthly payment that you pay according to the amortization system is divided into two different major payments. One of them goes toward the principal that you pay, and they insist actually in charging you the exact amount that they have invested with you. So if they pay $200,000, they ask you to pay them back $200,000. Throughout the payment plan, they rent you their share. The rent actually money, the rent revenue, is the profit that they make. Now, how do they get their money back? That's another good question. They deal in the secondary market. But if you agree with me that they own a certain percentage of the house, undefined, you own 5%, they own 95%. They turn around next day and they sell that share of the property to Freddie Mac. They are not selling the loan to Freddie Mac, they are selling their share to Freddie Mac. They said, and I do not have any document to prove whether or not what they claim is correct, but this is what they said. This is what my friend, the CEO of Guidance Residential, told me, that we have developed a special agreement with Freddie Mac to buy our share in the property. So if you sell a contract, if you sell a loan, okay, if Guidance Residential, if Guidance Residential, well, in the regular traditional system, the mortgage companies sell the loan to Freddie Mac. They lend you $200,000 and they go back to Freddie Mac and sell it for $190,000. So they exchange money for money, which is straightforward riba, bay'u ad-dayn bid-dayn. When it comes to guidance in particular, they do not sell the money with cheap or with discount to Freddie Mac. They sell their share to Freddie Mac. So they own 95% of the house. They sell, their ownership to Freddie Mac with a discounted price, and there's nothing wrong with that. If that is proven to be correct, then honestly, I do not see any issue with that. I will take maybe just one question there. Laribachi is completely different. They go with they call it diminishing partnership or بيع العين واستثناء المنفعة, but their application actually is wrong. Now,
Assalamu alaikum. Let us raise those who have a question, and let us give a number, and we can follow that one, and we're going to give the sisters first, if you have it, and I have a doctor first, and anybody, raise your hand, those who have, okay, number one, two, three, four, five, six,
let's move on,
seven.
No, we're wasting time. Sisters, actually, they have a question, do not mess with the sisters, then. You will be in trouble later on.
Assalamu alaikum. My question is, what about getting home equity loan through guidance? Is that halal?
What is the question again?
Home equity loan.
Home equity loan. Can you elaborate more? What does it mean, home equity loan?
Like you own a house and then you need some money. You go through guidance and you borrow this money from them and your house will be used as a collateral for the loan.
Can you elaborate what does it mean, refinance cash out?
So what he's talking about, that when guidance buy his share in the house, like let's say he wants, he owns a house for $400,000 and he wants $300,000. So we pay $300,000, we own 75% of the house, so he gets the money, he can do whatever he wants, and we go back to the same diminishing partnership.
So basically, you buy his equity?
No. We buy the house, actually, the share in the house. So he has a house, and he wants to just want some money. So we pay him this money. We see how much is the value of the house in the market, and we say, okay, that will make us owners in that house for 40%, 60%, and then we sell it back to him with the same amount, and we charge him the rent for that amount that we own.
Is he a guidance residential customer when he approaches you for asking you for money, or he has like a clear title house?
He could have had a clear title.
His own house.
He has his own house.
Clear title. Okay.
Or he can be still with another company, with another bank, and we pay that bank to take that bank out, and we will own that part of accordingly.
Let's go with the simple scenario that he owns a house with a clear title.
Yeah.
And the market value is $400,000, and he's looking for $300,000 loan. Is that correct, Akhi? Okay, how does it work?
We give him $300,000, and we buy 75% of the house.
You do appraisal, you go through the process.
We do the appraisal, we do all that, and we establish the LLC and all the whole thing. As if we are buying, it's the same concept as he's buying the house. He's putting 25%, we put 75%, but in this case, he will not bring the 25%. We will bring the 75%.
So you get involved as a partner then?
Yes.
He sells you 75%
correct.
Of his house,
yeah.
And he gets it cash money.
Correct.
And then what happens after that?
The same thing as we do with the purchase. We rent him our share, and he pays back our 75%. It's the same purchase, the same concept of purchasing.
I'm just brainstorming. I'm not giving a professional opinion or fatwa. There might be bay' al-'ain involved here. It might be. Arafat? Because the main reason behind that is not to get guidance residential involved in a partnership. Your main goal is to get cash money, is to borrow money. So if they buy your share and they start selling you the share one more time, again, it might be bay' al-'ina, it might be. The Prophet ﷺ prohibited. Bay' al-'ina is a very simple concept. This phone actually worth $100. Okay, so I'm selling you my phone for $100 credit sale. You pay me later on. Okay, up to this point, the phone is yours. Is that correct? The phone is yours, and you owe me $100. On the spot, before even I give you the phone, you sell your phone to me back $80 cash. $80 cash. Okay, and I give you $80. And the phone actually is with me. The phone is with me. We ended up that I gave you $80 and you pay me back how much? 100. And we just involved the phone in between, although it was not meant to be as such, only to justify the transaction. I'm just thinking loud. I'm not saying that this is the case with guidance, but there might be some bay'ul 'ina involved. My answer is there is no answer. I need to investigate it more and verify with guidance. How do they do it? What kind of fatwa they have? Okay, is the fatwa like 100% comply with what they do or not? That's a homework for me. JazakAllah khair. I'll work on it. So I have no answer. No.
Inshallah, let me make a disclaimer. This event is not sponsored by guidance, even though the question is coming through them. So we just want to make clear that inshallah he's giving Islamic fatwa, so it has nothing to do with Ahmed. I want him to step out as much as he can, inshallah. JazakAllah khair.
Before I forget, this event actually is sponsored by ICNA Relief. ICNA Relief is one of the most active Islamic charity organizations in the U.S. They have a lot of programs. Sorry.
Just 1 second, please. Give me just 1 second.
Okay, they have a back to school and a package and disaster response services and women shelter and on. I know the leadership of this organization. They have been operating in the U.S. maybe for the last 10 or 15 years. Very trustworthy organization. They might come to your masjid one day and ask for your support. Please support them generously and pay zakat and man an extra donation for this organization. This is my business card. If you are interested in Al-Huda University programs that we have bachelor's degree in Islamic studies, baccalaureate Sharia al-Islami. We have master's in Islamic finance and master's in Islamic education. I would love to see some of your community members joining Al-Huda University or Guidance College. If you did not support Al-Huda University for the new masjid project, please make sure that you take a pledge, fill it out, and give it back to me. If you already pledged yesterday and you did not fulfill your pledge, please make sure that you fulfill your pledge as soon as possible. I'll be, inshallah, leaving, going back to Houston tomorrow morning, inshallah. Let's continue.
Next question. Assalamu alaikum. Correct me if I am wrong. You give us an example, like when we pay late fees for the electricity, is direct riba. How is it riba, although we know the late charge, like it's $12 after the fifth of the month? I couldn't get how it is riba.
It is riba because technically you owe the utility company a certain amount of money, okay? And the debt actually takes the same rules of the loan. You did not borrow from the electricity company 150, but you owe them 150 because you have been using the electricity for one complete month. So whatever you owe them will be counted, will be interpreted as a loan, as if you have borrowed that money. And if you have to pay more than what you owe them, then that is riba. Late fees actually could not be charged, basically, unless in one particular case, that if collecting the debt involves cost, like for example, the utility company refers your account, for example, to an attorney or collection agency, and they pay for that, then they can collect late fees. They can collect late fees, but they have to make sure that they pay it to the collection agency and not putting it on their on their own pocket. From your side as a customer, as a practicing Muslim, you make sure that you just pay the total amount before the due date. Do not subject yourself to paying late fees. I wish I answered the question.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. So my question is really, I love Akh Ahmed on guidance. More than that, I'm maqtani' bil iftal, majlis al-iftal al-Arabi. The question I have, I didn't know about the selling the portion after you make the contract. Now, if we are both of us partners in that laptop in front of you, Can you sell your share without consulting me or not?
That is, I mean, they justify their model as Sharikatul Milk. Sharikatul Milk is different than Sharikatul Aqd. Sharikatul Aqd is the contractual partnership. Sharikatul Milk is the acquisition partnership. Based on the acquisition partnership, if you agree that this justification is legitimate enough, number one, they ask for own principle that they contributed in this contract. And number two, it's a well-known practice, well-known for everybody, that those companies actually deal in the secondary market, well-known. So you know in advance that they're going to sell their share to a third party. And number three, if you have a priority of buying it by a shufa, preemption, and you are willing to pay them the $200,000, then why you finance with them to start with? Because, I mean, you know very well that if they pay $200,000 with $100,000 profit for the next 30 years, okay? If you pay them tomorrow morning $200,000, then you're good to go. They cannot charge you profit. Is that correct? Because you need their finance, you get involved in partnership with them, and you are willing to pay them profit, or call it whatever you want. It is actually a profit for renting, you know, their share until you buy their share gradually. But in reality, they cannot operate, they cannot function without having money. That's why, I mean, next day in the morning or after 2 or 3 weeks, they just turn around and sell that contract or their share of ownership in the house in the secondary market and just get their money. Clear in the paperwork that you signed that they do have the right. Well, you should. I mean, they make it clear in the agreement and the paperwork that you signed that they do have the right to, you know, deal in the secondary market and sell it to whoever they want. So, I mean, there's a transparency between them and the client. No.
I'm going to give one more last question. Then, in the prayer hall, the rest of the questions will be answered, inshallah. How long you can stay at the salah? As much as they want.
Until tomorrow morning.
So right after the salah, we remain seated so that we could continue, inshallah, with the question.
Salaam alayhi hatta.
Just one. Assalamu alaikum, inshallah. Yes, ma'am. Assalamu alaikum, inshallah. So, doctor, you just said that the Islamic financing shares certain level of risk. Can you elaborate on that? How far do they share that risk? For example, if there's a housing crisis like we had in 07, 08, and the house gets depreciated, does the Islamic financing take that responsibility?
Generally speaking, Akhid, yani they take a certain level of risk. One of the concerns that we have when it comes to some of those companies and even Guidance Residential in particular is the justification of the contract as Sharikatul Milk, like the acquisition ownership, in which they secure and guarantee their principal. Although the main reason behind partnering with you as a partner is to make money. I mean, they do not have a plan to stay with your partners forever. The whole issue is that they want to help you financing, and you help them making some money. So the whole actually justification on going with Sharikatul Milk is still something questionable. And that's why, I mean, our approval was like, you know, contingent to need. Like if you need, you can buy. If you add on top of that, you know, the fact that they waive themselves or excuse themselves from paying the maintenance and the tax, and this actually, you know, adds like more concern. However, on the contrary, there is like certain scenarios. For example, when there is imminent domain, and natural disaster. If that, Allah forbids, happen, then they share the loss with you. Eminent domain, eminent, like when the property is owned by force by the authority, and the other one is the natural disaster. In those particular two scenarios, you share the loss with the, what was that? Foreclosure. So eminent domain, natural disaster, and foreclosure. Do you share the loss with the client? You take the whole loss? Foreclosure? So those again, just an example that there is a certain level of risk. We do not, we don't like to see those companies losing, but we want to make sure that they are subject to loss by taking some responsibility and some liability. We would love to see them like flourishing and proceeding with their business and making money, but in a halal, in a halal way. Now, it's up to the Sheikh.